Holy Spirit, enlighten our hearts to see the things that are of God. Come, Holy Spirit, our minds, that we may know the things that are of God. Come, Holy Spirit, our souls, that we belong only to God. Sanctify all that we think, say, and do, that all will be for the glory of God. Amen. So today we celebrate the Feast of Our Lady of Sorrows. And it might actually sound kind of strange to us to have those two words together in one sentence. Celebration, right? We celebrate a feast, we rejoice in something wonderful on one hand. But on the other hand, what is it that we are celebrating? Our Lady of Sorrows. So sorrow, the seven swords, the suffering. And so how is it that we come together to celebrate suffering? It sounds a little strange when you think about it that way. And so we have to find a way to reconcile how these two things that seem very opposite are actually joined together. And they are joined by a tremendous mystery. And that mystery is one in which we all participate, and we call it the mystery of the mystical body of Christ, the Church. Okay? So that's what this reflection is going to be on. That's the topic for today. So let us first consider suffering. There are tremendous sufferings in our world today. Everyone has a cross. Every single person you know is suffering in some way. It's clearly an inescapable part of life. It's part of everyone's life, and there's no way we can deny that fact. But I find it very interesting that suffering seems to have no value today. Everyone tries to avoid it, tries to escape it. In fact, most of the world's religions seem to try to find a way to overcome suffering. If you look at Buddhism, Buddhism seeks to avoid suffering at all, to stop desiring something so that the effect, which is suffering, according to their theology, vanishes as well. And so they just avoid suffering altogether. In Hinduism, you have this idea of karma, and that your suffering is something that you deserve, and so you have to kind of accept it, but you try to avoid it by living a good life so that good karma will come and you don't have to suffer. Right? So there are difficulties with suffering throughout our world. In our Catholic faith, we have a very unique approach to suffering, because we understand it as being salvific and redemptive. And we see that there is value in suffering. And so that's what we're going to look at today. I find it absolutely beautiful that our pastor, Father George Novak, has once again dedicated this day as a day of prayer for persecuted Christians. Okay? And he has actually requested that each person today offer their own prayers and sacrifices for persecuted Christians. And we offer those through the intercession of Our Lady of Sorrows. And she's our mother, and so she knows exactly how to present those sufferings and those petitions to her son. So, just yesterday, Pope Francis celebrated Mass in Rome for Father Jacques Hamal. He was the French priest who was killed by jihadists while presiding over morning Mass. They decapitated him. Right? He was in his 80s, this elderly priest celebrating Mass. And Pope Francis described Father Hamal as a good, gentle man and stated that he was indeed a martyr. He was a martyr for the faith. And during his homily, Pope Francis declared that killing in God's name is satanic. He further added that the church has more Christian martyrs today than in the first centuries. And he also added that Christians are currently suffering persecution by being imprisoned, tortured, and killed because they refuse to deny Jesus. Next week, this coming Saturday, on September 24th, Pope Francis will meet with relatives of the 86 victims that were killed in Nice, France, when the jihadist took his truck and for 2 kilometers just plowed into pedestrians on the streets. So 86 people killed there like that. And just 2 days ago, if you noticed on the news, ISIS released an execution video in which they had dozens of men all dressed in their purple jumpsuits hanging upside down on meat cleavers in a slaughterhouse. And all of them were then slaughtered. They had their necks cut. So this is our reality for Christians today. This is our reality. And it's very timely that today we're celebrating this Mass for persecuted Christians. So we need to continue to pray for them. We cannot forget about them. And we need to turn to Mary, Our Lady of Sorrows, for that intention. In times of sorrow, it is very important for us to come together to pray. And although we can always pray privately, it's imperative that we actually engage in public prayer. You see, there are 2 types of prayer. There's private prayer and public prayer. Okay? When we pray privately, we are completely and totally in control of what we say and do, in a way. When we pray, what we pray, who we pray for, what we pray for, it's up to us, because that's our private prayer. And we need to have a very strong personal prayer life. Public prayer is different. Public prayer is the liturgy of the church. It doesn't belong to us individually. It belongs to all of us collectively. And so with public prayer, we have the liturgy of the hours. We have the sacraments. Preeminently, we have the liturgy of the Mass, the holy sacrifice of the Mass. So, you remember how Jesus said, when you pray, go to your room, because your Father who sees in secret will reward you for what is done in secret. Remember that? A lot of people take that passage and then say, well, then why do I have to go to church? Can't I just pray on my own? Why do I have to go to Mass? Well, the reason is because we actually belong to a community, right? Where 2 or 3 are gathered in His name, there I am in the midst of them. That's what Jesus says. And so the reason why this is so crucial, why we need to come to church, why we don't just pray alone at home, is because we need to participate in the Mass. Even if we do not receive Holy Communion, we need to participate in the Mass. The reason we need to do that is because it's in the Mass that we worship through Him, with Him, and in Him. Do you recognize those words? That's called the doxology. The doxology, it's when the priest takes the sacred host and the chalice, elevates them, and prays that prayer through Him, with Him, and in Him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All glory and honor are yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. And we all respond with the great Amen. You might not realize it, but that is the climax of the Mass. That is the highest point of the Mass, the great Amen. When we say together in one voice, yes, Amen, this is true. When we pray those words, we have to realize what they mean. Okay? And that's what I'd like to look at a little bit right now. Through Him, with Him, and in Him. These are actually three different forms of prayer, or you could say three different levels of unity in prayer. Okay? So first we have the phrase, through him. Okay? This reveals that we approach Jesus as our mediator, the one mediator between God and man. Okay? We go to God, the Father, through him. And Jesus said that, no one comes to the Father except through me. That's what he said. And so we affirm the words of Jesus by going through him. He is our only means of reaching God the Father. Jesus makes himself available to us, but he does not force us. He leaves it up to us. We have free will. Here's another way to look at that same idea. And this is a little bit simplistic. I realize that, okay? But it's important to realize. We are the ones who initiate the encounter. And he takes a more passive role when we pray through him. Okay? When we pray through Jesus, it's almost as if he's like the conduit or the channel of grace. We go to the Father through him. We choose what to say. We choose when to say it. We retain our autonomy, our power. When we approach God through Jesus, there is a sense in which we are active and Jesus assumes the role of an instrument, much more passive. Okay? And it's because of his profound humility that he's willing to do that, to be an instrument for us to reach the Father. But there's another level of prayer, and that's with him, together with him. This reveals a partnership in prayer. We stand next to Jesus in friendship. He clothed himself with our humanity and came down and became one of us. He came down to our level so that we could stand side by side with him, so that he could be our brother. And he embraces us as our brother. He allows us to cooperate with his grace, just like he allowed Simon the Cyrenian to carry his cross. So we can walk beside Jesus, carry his cross with him, together with him. Not because Jesus is incapable of doing it alone, but because he invites us to be his friend and to join with him in that sacrifice. So we willingly in this way we work together with him, with his grace. He shows us the way and we actively follow. And when you think of the Our Father, that prayer that Jesus gave us, that's what he is praying here. We are praying together with him, our Father who art in heaven. So he gives us his Father so we can pray together with him. But there's a third level, through him, with him, in him. Okay? This is the deepest form of prayer, we could say. We are incorporated into Christ. Corpus means body. Incorporated means we become members of his mystical body, organically united to him. And so Jesus takes us up into himself, and we willingly surrender to his will. We allow him to speak for us while we unite ourselves to him. We live out the words, thy will be done. We surrender to him. And so there is a sort of change that takes place between all three of these. There's through him, where we have more power than Christ, then with him, and then in him, when we surrender ourselves and Christ takes over. And it's his Holy Spirit within us, praying to the Father with inconceivable groanings. This is a mystical level of prayer. We can call it contemplation, where we go ever deeper into this union with Christ. So it's his Holy Spirit that unites us all and allows this to happen, his Spirit dwelling within us. We, members of his body, he, the head. So together, we are one body in Christ. Now these expressions, such as in Christ, in Him, in the Lord, they occur in the New Testament, in the letters of St. Paul, over 164 times. That's just the letters of St. Paul. This is a profound mystery that's very, very important. And it's something that's repeated often in Scripture, that we really need to understand how to enter into Christ so that we can pray in Him. And it's a new reality for us as Christians that we are actually allowed to participate in this way. This is absolutely new. So notice that each form of prayer, through Him, with Him, and in Him, builds on the other. It's not that we get rid of praying through Him. We maintain that as well. It has its value. It's absolutely beautiful. We don't want to lose it. There are different moments in our lives when we need to approach the Father through Christ, as opposed to in Christ. There will be moments when we do not feel so united. There will be moments when, through our sin, we have separated ourselves, and we need to go back and pray through Him, with Him, in Him. But also notice the word "and." It's through Him and with Him and in Him. In the liturgy of the Mass, we do all three all the time. All three. But they clearly do culminate in the final expression, in Him. So this is so important because we are saved not as individuals on our own terms. In Catholic theology, we don't have that idea of being personally, individually saved, right? We have the concept that it is Christ who is saved, and we are saved because we are members of His body. And so only insofar as we are united to Him are we saved. So that's why it's so important to realize that being incorporated into Christ is the starting point of our union with Him and of our salvation. So this idea of being in Christ is made explicit in the liturgy of the Mass. We come together in a particular place, such as this beautiful church. We sing together with one voice. We stand together. We kneel together. We sit together. And even when we sit, we don't sit on individual chairs. We sit on a really wide chair that we call a pew, so others can join us, right? Because we are not supposed to be here individually. We are here communally. And when we get together and congregate like this as one body, something amazing happens. Rather than each person making up their own little prayers and praying to God individually, we learn and memorize prayers so that we can pray together with one voice. One voice. Why? Why do we do all this? Well, it's in order to convey to God and to the world that we are one. This is the point of it all, that we are one. And for this reason, we actually refrain from indulging in our own personal desires. We choose to be part of the body of Christ. Oftentimes, during weekday Mass, we might be invited to participate with petitions. Priest might open that up. Are there any other petitions? We have to remember, we can't pray for our own personal petitions. It's not that it's bad. There's nothing wrong with praying for your personal petitions. But this is not the place, because we are together in a community. And so instead of saying, "For my friend Sharon, who's struggling with cancer," we are supposed to say something more like, "For all of those who are struggling with cancer." And your friend is incorporated into that. There's another aspect to that. Sometimes we feel We want to be more reverent. We love God so much. It's not enough to follow the prescriptions of the liturgy. We want to kneel throughout the whole Mass. Right? Do you ever feel that? Right? You just want to kneel all the time. And people are standing and sitting. But it's interesting because this is not the time to express your own personal devotions. It's the liturgy of the Mass. And we are not here as individuals, we are here as a body. And so, barring any physical ailments or age that would limit us, either very young or very old, we try to kneel when everyone else kneels, stand when everyone else stands, sit when everyone else sits, even though we might feel like it's more respectful to kneel throughout the whole Mass. Right? Does that make sense? It's extremely important, and it conveys to us and to the world a humility that we are able to say, I surrender this desire. Your will be done. You have composed a liturgy through your church, and I respect that. And I unite myself with that. Okay? And so we need to choose constantly to be members of this body. And it's not always easy. I know for myself, I would pray in Eucharistic adoration, and I'd have my hour. And if someone else came in my hour, I'd get upset. Why are they here? I don't want them here. I want to pray in my hour. How immature, right? How selfish. Instead of rejoicing that yet another person comes to worship the Lord, I should hope that everyone would come, that the church be filled, instead of wanting my own personal private time. And so we do need to kind of grow in that openness. This is why the general instruction for the Roman Missal actually tells us that preserving unity is more important than the appointed posture. Okay? So sometimes you go to a different diocese and they're all standing after communion. That means you stand too. We must understand that our physical unity during Mass expresses a spiritual reality. So what is this reality that's being expressed? Well, it's the mystical experience of being members of Christ's body, the Church. The mystical experience of how we are each individual members of Christ's body, and when we come together, we remember Christ. And so Christ is represented by the priest who stands in the person of Christ, in persona Christi. And you'll notice that the priest stands in the sanctuary during the Mass. That's the head of the body. And you'll notice that the church is in a particular shape. And we're very blessed because our church actually is in a particular shape. And that's cruciform. We have two arms and the body and the head. So the reason we are one body in a church like this is to reveal to us that we are united to Christ on the cross. We are here together on the cross with Him. And you might look around and you might say, well, there are some people that should be here and they're not here. Yeah. Those are the wounds of Christ. Those are the holes in His hands, in His feet, in His side. We need to reach out and bring those people into the body. They're already baptized, many of them. They already belong to the body, but they're not here. We need to bring them back because we are the body of Christ. And so when we realize that that's what we are doing here, we are members of the mystical body of Christ, come together for his sacrifice to the Father in the liturgy of the Mass, then we can realize that we need to surrender even more. We need to participate more fully, more perfectly. This is intended to be a holy communion, in perfect union with Christ and with one another. So through Christ, we become one with one another. So you're all my brothers and sisters. We are one family, one body. Absolutely beautiful. And now, hopefully, we can see the tremendous privilege that is actually ours. We can participate in his Paschal mystery. See, we don't have a right to participate in his mystery, in his self-sacrifice to the Father, in his passion, death, resurrection, and ascension into heaven. But he gives us this as a privilege. It's a gift to us that we can participate. It might sound strange, right? You're allowed to suffer with me. But it is actually beautiful. And you'll probably notice that in your own lives, when you are suffering, you don't let just anyone in. You have to really trust that person. You have to really love them to open yourself up and allow them to share in your suffering. Christ does that for us. He opens himself up and lets us share in his Paschal mystery, in his suffering. But he does more than that, even more. In the words of St. Paul, we too can now say, in my flesh, I complete what is lacking in the suffering of Christ for the sake of his body, the Church. Colossians 1:24. You and I can actually offer up something. We can offer up our suffering in union with the sufferings of Christ for the benefit of another person. This is called redemptive suffering. So he suffered for us, and now because we're members of his body, we can suffer for one another. So what is redemptive suffering and how does it work? In the Bible, you may have remembered the story of Job. Job suffers a great deal. He loses his livestock, his fortune. He loses his farm, he loses his children, and eventually he loses his own health. He suffers, but he doesn't know why. He doesn't understand why he suffers, because he believes he's done good. He believes he's been righteous and holy. And his three friends conclude that, no, it's because you've sinned, because suffering is a punishment, they think. But God himself comes down and declares that Job is innocent. And so we learn a lesson. We learn that even the innocent suffer. That it's not a punishment from God. Even the innocent suffer. Then in the book of Isaiah, chapter 53, we hear about the suffering servant. And we find out from there that an innocent person can actually suffer on behalf of another person. This is what it says. He was pierced for our transgressions, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his wounds we are healed. The Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, he was silent and opened not his mouth. And so, this is a new revelation in the Old Testament. The fact that someone can suffer on behalf of other people. But it was also a prophecy because no one knew who this suffering servant would be. And then we find out from John the Baptist, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. We find out from John the Baptist that Jesus is that suffering servant. And he, by being sacrificed, sacrifice like the lamb, like the Passover lamb, will take away the sins of other people, all of us. And he does that. But how do we know that Christ's death on the cross was sacrificial? How do we know it was a sacrifice and not just an execution? Well, because he offered it up. That's a phrase we know, right? Offer it up. You've heard that? Offer it up. That's what transforms everything. When we offer it up, the love with which we offer up a suffering, transforms that suffering into a sacrifice. Okay? Let me say that again. When we offer it up, the love with which we offer it up transforms our suffering into a sacrifice. It's no longer just suffering. It's a sacrifice. And a sacrifice, think of the word sacrifice. Sacra facere. Sacra, sacred, holy. And facere, to make. So when we sacrifice, we are made holy. What we offer is made holy. Who we offer it for is made holy. So the sacrifice, the sacrificial nature of the offering is what transforms suffering into salvific suffering, redemptive suffering. Okay? That's the mechanism. It's the offering it up because it makes it a sacrifice. Now, we do this in union with the sufferings of Christ. In union with his, because his suffering has that salvific value. So, Jesus offered up his life. It wasn't taken from him. He actually said, "No one takes my life, I give it freely." He also revealed the day of his sacrifice. At the Last Supper, "This is my body given for you. This is my blood poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins." He offered himself, he sacrificed himself. On Friday, he demonstrated a little bit of that as well, but not too many people noticed, right? Because not too many people were there at the crucifixion. But at the crucifixion, they stripped him. And as they stripped him, they noticed something he was wearing. He was wearing a special garment, a garment that was woven in one piece from top to bottom. Do you remember that? And because it was woven, the soldiers couldn't tear it. For the other pieces of clothing, the outer garments, they ripped them apart into four pieces and divided them among themselves. But for the other garment, the underneath part, it was one piece, woven in one piece. They couldn't do anything, but they gambled for it. So they couldn't rip it apart. They gambled for it. Now this is significant because it's only the great high priest in the Old Testament that has a garment that's woven in one piece from top to bottom. And so Jesus is declaring by wearing this garment that he is the great high priest, that he is making a sacrifice of himself. And it's very unique, the day on which this special garment was worn. It wasn't worn for just any sacrifice. It was worn on the one day of Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, the day on which sin is forgiven and atoned for by the blood of the Lamb. So, Jesus was the great high priest who offered the unblemished, perfect sacrifice of himself to God the Father. And this is how we know that he was a priest, because he had a sacrifice. That's what priests do. They sacrifice something. That's what a priest is. A lot of different religious traditions don't have priests. They have ministers who minister to the needs of the people, minister to the needs of God. but we have priests because they offer sacrifices. Now, if we think about that, we realize that we, as members of the mystical body of Christ, who is the great high priest, we therefore share in his priesthood. Not the magisterial priesthood, the ministerial priesthood, but we share the common priesthood of Christ by virtue of being members of his mystical body. But that reveals something to us. That means that we too must offer sacrifice if we are to live out that dimension of our common priesthood. We have to offer sacrifice. So what do we offer? Well, St. Paul tells us in the book of Romans, chapter 12, verse 1, he tells us, offer yourselves, offer your bodies as a living sacrifice. And that's an interesting phrase, a living sacrifice, isn't it? Because all sacrifices in the Old Covenant, in the Old Testament, they were dead sacrifices. First you killed the animal, and then you offered it to God. But St. Paul is telling us, offer yourselves as a living sacrifice. Now there's a difference between being a living sacrifice and a dead sacrifice, right? A living sacrifice is able to crawl off the altar and refuse to sacrifice itself. But we have the choice to remain on the altar and be immolated with Christ, offering up our sacrifices, our sufferings, in union with him. But it has to be according to our free will. And that's what makes the difference. That's why being a living sacrifice is much, much more difficult. So love is what transforms the suffering into a sacrifice. When it is offered up. Only love can do this. Without the offering, there would be no suffering, right? So that is why, again, it's just so important for us to offer it up. Remember that we have to offer it up. As members of his mystical body, we participate in his priesthood, and we can offer up our sufferings in two ways. We can do it formally or informally. Now, informally, we do it whenever the occasion arises, whenever we feel pain, whenever we feel lonely, whenever we feel upset or hurt or depressed or alienated. Whatever is happening, we can offer that up immediately to the Father in an informal way. But there's also a formal way that we offer this sacrifice, and that's in the liturgy, through the Mass. In fact, we can just participate in the sacrifice that the priest is offering on our behalf, right, in union with Christ's sufferings, to the Father. And in your pews, you actually have this booklet. I'm just going to show you one passage here on page 203. This is from the Eucharistic Prayer, the third Eucharistic Prayer. And it's the second paragraph on page 203. It says, look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, are filled with the Holy Spirit, and filled with the Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. So first of all, that's what he prays. Make us one. And then he says, may he make of us an eternal offering to you. This is what the priest is praying, that we all become an eternal sacrifice to God. So it's in this time that we are offering ourselves through the Mass. You might not even be aware that this is happening. Sometimes we don't really pay attention, but the priest is offering you to God the Father as part of his living sacrifice. And so when he elevates the Sacred Host and the Precious Cup, right, That is a perfect moment to offer yourself intentionally. Give yourself to God. So, there is an amazing document that I would like to recommend to all of you. It's by Pope John Paul II, and it's called Salvifici Doloris. It's on the Christian meaning of suffering. It's an apostolic letter. And it's very short, but very profound and very beautiful. And in it, he explained why God chose to redeem the world through the suffering of Jesus, and how it now affects us. So he writes, and I quote, "With the passion of Christ, all human suffering has found itself in a new situation. In the cross of Christ, not only is the redemption accomplished through suffering, but also human suffering itself has been redeemed. Christ, without any fault of his own, took on himself the total evil of sin. The experience of this evil determined the incomparable extent of Christ's suffering, which became the price of the redemption." So, I hope you got the point of that. Christ did two things by suffering on the cross. He redeemed us. He redeemed the whole world. But he also redeemed suffering. Prior to Christ's suffering and death on the cross, everyone else's suffering was meaningless. There was no point to it. It was simply suffering that we wanted to avoid. After the cross, suffering became salvific. That's what he changed. He changed what suffering was. Because whatever Christ touches, he redeems. Whatever he touches, he heals and makes whole. And so, when Jesus enters death, he transforms it. He redeems death. Death now loses its power because it can't hold us. Death becomes an entrance into new life. Do you see? He forever changes death. At the same time, he also enters into suffering. And when he enters into suffering, he transforms it. No longer is it meaningless and empty and something to be avoided. Now, if we choose to embrace it, right, within ourselves to the degree that we can, now it can become salvific. And we actually have the option of offering it for others. So, St. Peter writes in his first letter within sacred scripture, he says, "You know that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your fathers, not with perishable things such as silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot. The greatness of the redemption permeates the new covenant. The Redeemer suffered in place of man and for man. Therefore, every man has his own share in the redemption, and each one of us is called to share in that suffering through which the redemption was accomplished." But we have to realize that this is of our own free will. Here at St. Mary's Church, we are very blessed to be served by Resurrectionist priests. The Resurrectionists are an order that are devoted to the Paschal Mystery. So their charism is to resurrect society through lives conformed to the Paschal Mystery. And what is the Paschal Mystery? It's the suffering, death, resurrection, and ascension into heaven of Jesus. So they live out the desire that St. Paul spoke about when he said, "I want to know Jesus Christ and the power of his resurrection." That's from Philippians 3. Since we live in a culture of death, we need to embrace a resurrectionist spirituality and apply the merits merits and graces attained for us through the Paschal Mystery to every person who suffers, to every situation where death presents itself, including and most especially spiritual death, which is sin. So look around you. Is there death around you? Spiritual death and sin? Is there alienation or loneliness? Is there someone who is suffering in any way? That's where you go with the spirit of the resurrection, the power of the resurrection. Because when we live out of the mystery that we are members of the church, members of Christ's mystical body, and when we offer up our sufferings and unite them to Christ's sufferings, then love transforms our sufferings into a sacrifice, makes it salvific, right? And they participate in Christ's Paschal mystery. Therefore, the power of the resurrection now has a point of entry. So it's through this self-sacrifice that the resurrection, which is part of the Paschal mystery, now has a way of getting in and revealing its power, the power of the resurrection. And through the power of the resurrection, new life begins, new life that's filled with God's grace. And on top of all that, Christ allows us to apply this grace. We are actually allowed to choose the recipients. This is phenomenal, phenomenal. We can actually now say, Lord, take the pain I'm suffering right now and use it for my son who is alienated from the church. Use it for my uncle who is struggling with cancer. Use it for my friend who doesn't know how beautiful she is and sells herself short. We can say things like that. We can actually choose the person who receives that grace. I have a dear friend whose husband died of cancer, and he went through a very, very long time in the hospital, almost a year. And during that time, Father George went to visit him and explained redemptive suffering and taught him to pray the Chaplet of Mercy. And he taught him that for each day that he suffers, he can look into the future and choose either his son or his daughter or his wife that he's going to be leaving behind when he dies, and he can offer his suffering for them. And it transformed that man's life. Prior to that, he was waiting for death. He wanted to live, but he couldn't, the pain was too excruciating, and he wanted to die at the same time. And it was interesting because he was so upset that he was going to miss giving his daughter away at her wedding, miss his son's first baseball game. He was going to miss the graduations and his grandchildren. He was going to miss it all, and he was heartbroken that he was going to miss all this. But when he learned that he could go through their lives and say, there will be a moment when they go to school and they're going to be rejected, for that suffering, for that pain, I'm going to offer my suffering to them. And it transformed him. And he wanted to live as long as he could, so he could offer more. That's the power and the beauty of redemptive suffering, that we can apply it to other people. We can actually choose this. It's a tremendous privilege. So, how generous God is to us, right? Just how beautiful. What a profound, powerful gift we have. Now you and I can participate in Christ's work of redemption. We can help transform darkness into light, suffering into joy, and death into life. We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed us.